Excellent. Thank you for coming back. You're obviously still enjoying it. So I'll say nothing more than Anthony Jacquin.
Very kind, very generous. Yes, and my name's Anthony Jacquin, and I guess some of you know me because I wrote a little book called Reality is Plastic. And I don't know, for some reason it went down really well with performers, even though it was just geared toward doing hypnosis outside of the confines of the therapy room or traditional stage hypnosis. And they're two areas that had become a bit of a comfort zone for me. By the time I wrote that book, I'd treated the best part of 5,000 clients individually in therapy with the model that I was taught by my father, and we've bored our partner silly for the last 15 years talking about that and refining it. And I started doing stage hypnosis, and that was a bit of a leap. But again, once you've got a big audience in front of you and you know how stage hypnosis works, it becomes a bit of a comfort zone. It's not that difficult to pull off. It's difficult to make it fun and entertaining, but it's not that difficult to get the whole thing started. What I want to do today is, this is kind of billed as a bit of a cross-training event. I want to show you some of the things, techniques that I use in performance, stuff that I do on, when I say street hypnotism, by the way, I just mean out of the context of therapy and stage. It doesn't mean you have to be standing on a street corner with trucks whizzing by. An impromptu demonstration, the kind of thing James was speaking about. I'm going to go over some of the things that I regularly do when I'm doing that kind of work, and you may not know this, but Dad certainly would. A lot of these techniques come straight out of our therapy system. And when James Tripp was speaking earlier about giving people an experience in therapy, that's been at the hub of our work, not quite from the beginning, because we did sit there for the first few years not wishing to squeak our chairs, not saying sleep, because they're not asleep. It would be ridiculous. You might lose rapport. And ushering them out the door, and you know they're thinking, have I been hypnotised? And you've been thinking, I wonder if they were. You just hope that they get a result, and very often they would get a result. But the moment we started adding hypnotic phenomena into that, and I mean what you know, you may consider kind of basic phenomena, physical phenomena, analogue physical phenomena like arm levitation, catalepsy, people actually getting stuck and kind of bound into a situation. We know that when we started adding that into an existing therapy system, we got better results and we got busier, because when the person left, I think it was mentioned earlier, when I questioned about the experience, it wasn't just, yeah, he spoke to me and what happened? I don't know, I shut my eyes, what happened? He spoke to me some more. I guess I was just ready to change, or, you know, I made my decision. They would speak about the phenomenon. They'd say, I don't know, he spoke to me, my hand was stuck to my face, I've got no idea what happened. Now, that, to some, if you don't do that kind of thing in your therapy work, may seem like bad taste, and it may seem like it's just the hypnotist, you know, flexing his ego. But we found real value in it. So when I started performing in impromptu situations, I would use exactly these phenomena. I would use physical phenomena, move into kind of emotional changes, and then really try and get into the bigger bits and pieces. So I'm going to show you kind of how I use some of that stuff in therapy. And for some of you, you'd have only seen me doing it in the context of performance. And likewise, I'm going to show you some things that I do in therapy that I think add to performance. And I'm very much a fan of, again, I keep referring to James Tripp's lecture there, but making people feel good. Kev and I used to call it uninvited therapy. Sometimes we call it random acts of kindness, which is a phrase which has seemed to crept into the language. Apparently it was a phrase written down by a hippie on her way back from Woodstock years ago on a placemat in a cafe. Practice random acts of kindness and senseless acts of beauty. And I'm very much into both of those sentiments. So we're going to talk about some of that. And again, if you have questions, you know, as I'm going through this for the next 45 minutes or so, feel free to ask the question. If I think I'm going to answer it, then later on I'll just say so. And I'll save 5 or 10 minutes at the end for questions, if that's okay. All right? I want to start off by giving, if you like, more often than not when I'm teaching, I start with this demonstration. And it's the smallest possible thing I can show you. Sound right?
With his clothes on.
The smallest thing I can show you, but it kind of contains everything that I might want to teach someone if I was teaching them hypnosis or hypnotherapy. Okay, so I know quite a few of you. I'm looking for an unfamiliar face, someone I don't know. I don't know you, you're sitting there hiding at the back, not you, Wayne. You, sir. What's your name? Yeah.
Marcus.
Marcus, come up here if you would. You happy to volunteer?
Yeah.
Excellent. Let's give Marcus a round of applause. Good to see you. Thank you. In fact, turn this way and the audience knows you. You call that? We haven't met before registration today. I haven't hypnotised you before or anything like that. You're not hypnotised now. Excellent. Let's begin with a really simple demonstration. Can you just place your feet flat on the floor for me? Put your hands on your lap. Just move that off your hand. Are you left-handed or right-handed?
Right-handed.
You're right-handed. Okay, what I'd like you to do, you're going to use this hand, okay? I'd like you to just make a fist like this and just stare at the back of your hand. I'll keep talking to you. You can listen to me. Make it as tight as you can, though. Really mean it, as tight as you can. Now close your eyes, and with your eyes closed, I want you to concentrate on this fist, just on this fist. I know it's a bit of a strange thing to do, but really pay attention to the fact that your fingers are now digging into the palm of your hand. This thumb is wrapping around there even tighter, and you can probably feel the skin stretching over the back of your knuckles. Now with your eyes closed, what I want you to do is keep concentrating on that fist, and keep it as a fist, but let go of the tension in your fist. Just allow the tension to disappear. So it looks like a fist, but now the tension has just gone from your arm. We all know that we've got a pulse in our wrist and a pulse in our thumb, and that's why nurses will tell you not to take someone's pulse with your thumb. I want you to imagine in the palm of your hand right now, you're holding something that has a pulse, something about the size of a pebble that's perhaps expanding, contracting, and when you can feel the pulse in the palm of your hand, just nod your head so that I understand. Good. I'm going to click my fingers and that pulse will jump to your index finger. You'll feel it. Concentrate on your index finger. And when you can feel your index finger, when you can feel that pulse there, just nod your head for me. I'll click them again. It will jump to your little finger. When you can feel it in your little finger, nod your head. That's right. Now make a fist with this hand if you would. Make a, again, a loose fist just like that. Again, you can feel the pulse in this hand, yeah? I'm going to click my fingers. You're going to feel it jump straight to your right hand. It's going to jump straight over there. Tell me when you feel it in your right hand. Good, we're going to do this one more time again. Just keep your eyes closed for me. We'll turn this over. In fact, we'll put this one down here, put this one up here. Actually, just a little bit higher. I'm going to click them again. You're going to feel it jump from your lower hand to your upper hand. You'll feel a pulse just go bang, straight into your upper hand. You feel that? Good, you're doing brilliantly. Now just place your hands back down, concentrate on that pulse. And I'm going to ask you to do something now, and the surface is going to seem very simple to do. You understand you have a conscious mind, and there's this bigger part of you we sometimes call the unconscious. Runs every cell, every muscle in your body, every system. Consciously, Marcus, I'd like you to just guess which finger is going to jump to on this hand when I click my fingers. When I click my fingers, your pulse will jump again to another finger. Consciously right now, just make a guess in your mind, but it's your unconscious mind that's going to actually choose which finger it jumps to. So when I click my fingers, it will jump. Did you guess correctly? No. This demonstrates to me just how powerful your unconscious mind is. You have a super powerful creative mind. Now just open your eyes. You can undo this fist now. Just put your hands on your lap. You weren't hypnotized there, were you?
Felt like.
You felt like you was. Okay, that's fine. Just put your hand on mine. In fact, just look here, right underneath my eye. Just look right underneath my eye. I'm going to shake your hand three times. The first time that I shake your hand, your eyes are going to begin to change focus. The second time I shake your hand, they're going to get very heavy, very tired. Try and keep them on that spot. And the third time that I shake your hand, your eyes will close and you'll go into hypnosis. Not chewing gum, are you? Okay, let's just get rid of that. Put it in there if you would. Safety first. Just look right here. Now I'm going to shake your hand once. That's right, you're going to feel your eyes starting to tire. I shake them again, they get so heavy. That's right, try and keep them on that spot. And the third time I shake your hand, your eyes will close, you're going to hypnosis now. Sleep and relax. Deeper, deeper down, deeper into hypnosis. You sit back in the chair. That's right, a comfortable resting position for your head and your neck. I'm going to place your hands on your lap like this. That's right, nice and loose and limp and relaxed. You're doing brilliantly. Now, in a moment, what I'm going to do is I'm going to touch the back of your hand. And the next time I touch that hand, it's going to start to lift up towards your face. just like it's being pushed up on a cushion of air. You're going to feel it start to get light, your fingers will start to twitch, they're already starting to go, and you're going to feel that lightness just increasing. It's already starting to move, just like it's being pulled up towards your face by a magnetic force. It's going to get lighter and lighter, your fingers twitching, your wrists lifting, that's right, higher and higher, and the higher it gets, the better you're going to feel. In fact, you're going to enjoy an unusual sense of well-being as that pulled up towards your face. And I came across an idea, Marcus. There's something you'd love to feel differently about, something if you could just smile or laugh about it, you'd be so much better off. And as you think of that, it's going to start to seem funny to you. As that hand gets close to your face, that thing is going to start to seem funny. And you're going to drift up out of your body, you're going to see this thing from 5 miles up, 50 miles up, and then when your hand touches your face, you're going to burst out laughing as inappropriately as you possibly can, as you realise you can put this in its true perspective. Not just of your life, but, you know, of the country, of the world, of the universe. You can change the way you think in an instant. It's going to get funnier and funnier and funnier with every click of my fingers, with every passing second. This is going to seem less and less serious to you. You can realise that you can let go of every negative thought and limiting belief you ever had about this particular thing. So now when you try and think about it and take it seriously, it's going to seem funny to you for some unknown reason. Again, just try and take it seriously and just find this is ridiculous. This is ridiculous to you. That's right, you can put your hand down. When I put your hand down, that's right, you're just going to drift down deeper sleep now, deeper sleep. Letting go, sinking, floating, drifting down to sleep. Letting go, all the way down, deeper and deeper to sleep now. That's one thing, someone's showing you how to go into hypnosis, but I'm going to show you how you can take yourself into that state right now. From this moment forward, whenever you wish to return to this place, anytime it's safe and appropriate for you to do so, anytime it's safe and appropriate for you to go back into hypnosis and use your own imagination in this way, all you will need to do is sit quietly and repeat the word relax 4 times just in your mind. The 4th time you repeat that word, you'll go straight back down into this state of hypnosis instantly and immediately, anytime it's safe and appropriate to do so. Now when you do that, you could just chill out in this little zone of hypnosis. If you wanted to sleep, you could simply tell your mind with that inner voice of yours that when your head touches the pillow, you drift into a natural sleep. Or if you want to use this more specifically, you can literally just tell your mind, like it's there on your shoulder listening to you, what you want and when, how you will feel and when, and you'll remember that. You'll remember to use positive terms. You'll tell it what you want and when. You'll tell it how you will feel and when. Nod your head when that's understood and all on board. Good. Now, right now, I want you to do this. I don't want you to pretend. I don't want you to act. I want you to use that voice in your head. I want you to tell your unconscious to push your left hand up off your leg. Just repeat that in your mind. Tell your unconscious with that voice in your head to push your left hand up off your leg. And you'll feel it starting to go. And as it starts to go, what I want you to do is I want you to try and keep it in place. I want you to do your utmost to try and keep this in place. And again, you'll start to realize that the more conscious effort you put into that, the lighter it gets. And again, that's going to feel good. It's going to make you feel good. It's going to move up towards your face, and this time the laughter is going to be 10 times more raucous and ridiculous and uninhibited than it was before. It's going to get funnier and funnier and funnier. With every movement, every millimeter, that is going to seem ridiculous to you. As you realise you've taken control of this vast resource that we've been calling the unconscious, it's really you. It's the bigger part of you. It's the part of you that has all your memories and skills and resources. It runs every cell of your body. That's right, it's ridiculous to you. When I click my fingers again, you start to laugh like an old lady. You won't know why, but it'll feel great. You're going to start to titter like a posh old lady. That's right. Now, I think we'll stop there. Sleep and relax. Deeper, deeper down now. Deeper, deeper down. In a moment, I'm going to count to 5. On the count of 5, your eyes will open. You'll be back in the room, wide awake and alert, feeling amazing. The one thing you will remember is how to take yourself into kind of instant self-hypnosis. You'll be able to do this anytime it's safe and appropriate. You will also remember to use positive language when you're giving your unconscious mind direction, when you're trying to tap into those resources. You'll tell it what you want and when, rather than what you don't. You tell it how you're feeling and when, rather than how you won't. Again, nod your head when you understand. On a count of 5, you're going to wake up to a big round of applause, feeling amazing. Feeling like you've had an 8-hour sleep, feeling like you've had a 3-hour massage. Absolutely on top form. You're going to have a great weekend. So, 1, beginning to sit up. Your eyes still closed, but beginning to sit up. 2, feel a surge of energy pouring in through fingers and toes. In through those fingers and toes, all the way up, arms, legs, spine, neck, top of the head now. 3, take a deep breath in, Marcus. Fill your chest up with energy giving oxygen, that's right. 4, your head just being washed through with cool spring water now. And 5, eyes open. Give a round of applause. couple of things there. Again, quite small demonstrations, really, but things that I find really useful. I agree with James. This isn't all about trance. I've been doing this for 15 years, and at some point, I've had more or less kind of faith in the four or five hypnosis models that are out there. I don't think hypnosis is all about social compliance, but I absolutely want to be the dominant party in this hypnotic relationship. I'm going to manage compliance. I don't think it's a unique altered state. I really agree. It's a process, and to me, it's a process of communicating ideas, and it's a process of managing attention. So the very first demonstration I gave there actually comes from he's a magician. His name is Bill Cushman, and he wrote a little paper called Suggestibilities. It won't be of that much interest if you're not a magician. But he's also got 30 years experience as an Ericksonian hypnotherapist. And when he was a kid, he used to play the trumpet, and when he was on the bus, he would imagine playing his scales and different things, and he noticed his fingers starting to twitch. He started to experience some ideomotor movement. Sometimes they wouldn't move, but he would still feel the pulse kind of activating all the time. So I often start with that as a demonstration in impromptu situations, especially these kind of lower key situations where I'm not trying to draw a crowd. If I want a crowd, then I'll have someone with their arms stuck up in the air and, you know, jumping around and doing silly things and making lots of noise. But very often demonstrations are, oh, you're a hypnotist, can you hypnotise me? Yeah. Do you want to be hypnotised? Oh, yeah, I'd like to experience it, but I don't really want, you know, to be humiliated. And this is kind of my entry point to it. I use exactly that, exactly as I did it there as an induction in the therapy room sometimes. What's actually happening? Well, first off, I'm kind of by pointing him to place all of his attention on his fist. It's something you wouldn't normally do. I can kind of start to soft test and see if my suggestions are working, let alone if my instructions are being taken on board. And I'm going to talk about soft testing quite a lot. There's a few guys in the room I've learned who are serious martial arts experts and tear you apart with their bare hands, that kind of thing. I'm not a martial arts expert, but I'm very interested in martial arts. And one of the concepts that comes from Wing Chun, the style that I do, is this idea of sort of putting up a fence when someone's being aggressive and just giving them a soft little, it's called an asking hand, I think, just giving them a little touch just to see what happens, just to see if they want to come forward or backward or whether they're going to knock your hand out of the way. It's just a little touch like that. So very often when I'm giving demonstrations, I'll give a suggestion that to anyone listening will seem innocuous. Like, they start to do this and I'll say, this is going to seem a bit weird to you, or this is going to seem a bit funny to you, or this might make you laugh. And regardless of whether they do or not, I feel like I've kind of done my first little invisible bit of testing there. So even if I'm doing things that most of you will know, like magnetic fingers, magnetic hands, things that are predominantly based on the physiology of their body, if it's all kind of going quite well and they look really focused, I just say, this is going to freak you out. This is going to make you laugh. And then when they touch and they go, oh, that was weird, I think, good, strike one, I've got that. I've given them a little poke there and I seem to have got the response that I'm looking for. So in this situation, first thing first, James asked this question three times. I ask this question quite a lot. Are you left-handed or right-handed? Which, again, is kind of a bit of this witch doctor effect. To me, it doesn't make any difference. I'm not that hung up on the idea that we have our left brain, our right brain is all important to this. I don't mind which hand I work with. There's some argument that working with the left side is more likely to be their hypnotic side. I'm not entirely convinced about that. But I just work with the one that's convenient. Are you left-handed or right-handed? Good. Make a fist. So first off, it's just a process of giving instructions. Lots of the things I do start this way. Just give a load of instructions and see if they get into clip as quickly as possible. The famous yes set, if you like. Can you put your feet on the floor? Can you place your hands like this? Can you squeeze that fist nice and tight, even tighter, as tight as you can? I want to see that he's responding to every one of those instructions. Okay. By drawing his attention to things that are normally outside of his awareness, as far as I'm concerned, I am managing where his attention is. Forget whether he's in a trance or not, I'm not convinced he is. But I now feel, with these little nods of the head, with responding to every single thing that I'm doing, that I'm managing his attention. And then that entire routine is about managing his attention. The fact is you can't normally feel your pulse. I mean, some people can, but they're the people that clog up heart surgeries around the room, worried about their strange heartbeats. Most of the time, it's not a problem for them. It's just they become, kind of develop a phobia for that and want a third and a fourth opinion. But most of the time, the pulse is outside of your conscious awareness. So by putting someone's attention onto that, I already know that at least their attention is focused inside, and that's really where I want them to be, on thoughts and feelings and sensations and images and the ideas that I'm presenting, springboarding off of that. I'll normally just put this throwaway line in of, and everyone knows we've got a pulse in our wrist and a pulse in our thumb, that's why you shouldn't take someone's pulse with your thumb, which just seems to cement the bit of knowledge most people have about our pulse, that yeah, you can feel it in your wrist and your thumb. From then on, it's just a process of directing his attention. When you listen to my suggestions, you'll hear, and I encourage you to do this, I will always cue it up beforehand. I'll state exactly the outcome that I want, and then I'll kind of incrementally get to it. So I'll say, in a moment, you're going to notice, when I click my fingers, your pulse is going to jump to your index finger. And then I'm just all over his index finger. You don't really hear me mention anything else until he nods his head. Pay attention to your index finger. It may be in the tip of the finger when you can feel it. Nod your head for me. Excellent. I'll always give feedback. By the time that's kind of bounced 3 or 4 times, you can bounce it to his shoulder, his foot. You can bounce it to somebody else in the room. All they have to do is concentrate on their pulse. So there's quite a few things you can do with that very simple effect. If you want to use it as an induction, then that's how you present it. And you say, this time when it jumps, you're going to become twice as deeply relaxed. You can get them to imagine going through a series of colours in their mind, and each one's going to take them down, and it's all going to be in time with that pulse. You can use this as a mindfulness, kind of meditation type exercise, a self-hypnosis exercise. You can use it as a way of getting someone into self-hypnosis, that kind of thing. Because if they can be aware of that in the therapy room, they can do it elsewhere. So that's the jumping pulse, and I use it all over the place. I know it's easy to do, but I don't like to work too hard. So, yes?
That's the first time I've ever seen that, and it's really visual. When he was up there, it's incredible to watch.
Unfortunately, I can't make coins.
Yeah.
Any up, like James.
If that's what you do in the therapy room as an induction, as I said, that's the first time I've seen that. As a spectator, it's incredible to watch. Is it always that pronounced?
No, I mean, he was pretty receptive. I noticed as well, I was queuing up for this, he was kind of taking all those ideas on board. He was twitching and moving. I mentioned a finger. He actually started moving his other finger. That's all good feedback for me. Yeah. It was more a case of containing his response a little. But the pulse thing, I think I've done it hundreds of times. I think I've only had 1 or 2 cases where the person just can't feel their pulse in the first place. And perhaps Jorgen or James, who like to work with difficult people, can tell us how we might deal with that. But most of the time, if you take the time and you say, let's say it was taking a few seconds for them to get that first pulse, I just say you really have to empty yourself and still yourself and just concentrate, and you don't need to, you know, just focus them in. By the time they get it, they're kind of where I want them to be. And because I haven't mentioned induction or sleep or anything else, if it literally becomes, yes, I'm aware of your pulse and I think this is going to be an uphill struggle, I'll go somewhere, I'll do something else with them instead. But again, you could think, you know, it's interesting you're saying visual, because someone sitting there concentrating on a fist in their lap isn't necessarily the most visual thing, but you can make it big. You can do it with an audience. And the little bit I tagged on the end, just to draw some value out of that, there's a fantastic set of recordings by one of Milton Erickson's students called David Kaloff that you should all listen to if you haven't got. Really, really good. And he does something similar with, I can't remember if it's an arm levitation or finger levitation, where he kind of gives people the choice to consciously guess and encourages their unconscious to actually make the choice, regardless of what you think of the model of conscious and unconscious. The chances are, if he's concentrating on one, where you've got a 1 in 4 chance that he's going to get it wrong at that point. So I say I'm going to ask you to consciously make a guess, which implies you might get it wrong, but I'd like your unconscious mind to choose for you. And I then say, did you guess correctly? And if they say yes, I say, excellent, it shows me your conscious and your unconscious are perfectly synchronized. And if they say no, I say, there you go, it's the power of your unconscious mind, it's making decisions. And again, this is a tiny, I'm pointing you to a few different resources, but there's a set of lectures on Radio 4, I don't know if they still do them, called the Reith Lectures, R-E-I-T-H, and there's one particular lecture by a neuroscientist called Ramachandran, which you should all listen to, where there have been other experiments in this regard done since, which are even more impressive. But Ramachandran, you know, he's got the person's brain wired up. He's particularly looking at these elements of the brain that are responsible for each finger. And he says, look, in a moment I want you to make a decision to lift up one of your fingers. The very moment you choose, the very instant you make that decision, just let me know that, to press a button or something. And what he showed very, very clearly, that a good few seconds before that, the part of the brain solely responsible for their little finger, for example, had fired up into action. So by the time they make their conscious decision, it certainly feels like a free choice, if you want to put it that way, but it's going to be that finger already. It's already been decided prior to it becoming a choice. It's just they reflect on that and think, well, I chose it. So what that says about what it is to be a human being and the choice decisions we think we're making every day, I don't know. You'll have to draw your own conclusions. So that's the jumping pulse. Let's talk about the next little thing I did there. Again, this could be an induction. I know I actually did my version of Elman's triple induction. Elman's famous for being a brilliant hypnotist. He's equally famous for saying you cannot make people quit smoking using hypnotherapy. My dad's treated a good 20,000 smokers. I've treated a few thousand myself with great results. But one of Elman's inductions was to puff on a cigarette, apparently. And so the first puff, your eyes are going to feel tired. Second puff, they're going to get you having a third puff, you know, you're going to a trance. And I didn't really get that at first, because I just say that and that happens? That doesn't make sense. But now I use this a lot, especially with a handshake, because there is just so much expectation. You essentially rehearse the whole thing as you get their focus of attention, and upon each shake, you're then queuing up what you want to happen and what is going to happen. And then when your time gets to the third shake, I don't really give the person an option anyway. I just, you know, just encourage their head forward by touching them on the back of the head. So I like that induction. Occasionally I'll use it in therapy, but generally we use this thing called a power lift, my dad's creation, and he'll demonstrate on that on a group of you later on. When I work my way through the phenomena of hypnosis, again, in therapy, I don't really need more than what I call physical analog phenomena. That means if I go for arm levitation and a finger twitches, I call that success. If their arms stacked up here, that's success, and anything between is. So there's a nice scale. Physical binary phenomena or a test would be you can't lift it. It's stuck to the table. It's stuck to your head. You cannot remember your name. It's not half there. You either can say it or you can't. So the way I work through the phenomena is, once I've done my induction, is to establish in therapy an ideomotor signal, a movement. Now, those of you who know me from doing street hypnosis and that kind of performance, you'll know this is the first thing we learn on day one. We learn how to make someone's arm levitate. And by the time we go out, or the second day of training, quite a lot of people are thinking, are they even hypnotized? Let me tell you, when I first had that response in therapy, it was like a world of opportunities opened up, because prior to that point, I've been guilty of what many hypnotherapists are doing, never actually testing their work. You know, Kev will often ask people to introduce themselves as hypnotherapists, how do you know you hypnotize people? Well, I do an induction. How do you know they're hypnotized? Well, because I do. You know, that's about it. That's as much as you get out of them. So if you do your induction and then just test your work, don't be afraid, you know, to fail. There are other directions you can take this in. Test your work. If you make someone's finger twitch unconsciously, then the chances are they have not had that experience before, or certainly have not paid attention to it before. And all we do, and you're going to see this in my father Freddie Jacquin's demo later, is hook those responses in to classical patterns and techniques of therapy that most of you will be familiar with. Things like six-step reframes and phobia cures and timelines, but the whole time verifying it with the biggest movements we can. So in the demo I did there with Marcus, I managed to get his arm lifting. I'm happy with that. He's responding. The next thing I want is to get an emotional change in somebody. I want to make them laugh. So in that case, that's what happened. It didn't come completely unbridled and off the hook, or good for him, really. He's probably seen my DVD or something, and he knows where that routine goes. But either way, he you know, I got some laughter. And in this, normally, if I'm out doing this in performance, I wouldn't force this uninvited therapy of, there's something you'd love to feel differently about, something if you could laugh about it, smile about it, you'd be so much better off. But, you know, I'm quite happy to do that. I've finished therapy sessions where someone's saying, I'm not sure if I was hypnotised, I could hear what you were saying. And I've run that little demo with them. And I've had people say, that was worth the cost of the session. You don't know what went on in my head yet. It's quite important, should you ever do that, to ensure that this is something they'd be happy to smile or laugh about. One of the first times I did this, the guy's arms was lifting, and I said, I've got a feeling there's something that you'd just love to feel differently about. And I just left a bit too much of a gap. And he did laugh, and he came out, and he looked a bit bemused for a few seconds. And he said, 18 years ago, I was on a ship in the Falklands War, standing next to a buddy of mine, and we were machine gunned, and I was shot from my ankle right across my body, right up into my shoulder. That was not effing funny. He was a bit angry about it. He came in the next day and had the first full night's sleep he'd had since that moment. He hadn't thought about it, he hadn't ruminated on it, hadn't dreamt about it, and felt a hell of a lot better off, even though he didn't really know why that was the case. So you do have to be careful with this kind of stuff. But if I'm out doing a demonstration, it doesn't have to all be about hallucinations. If I can get some physical phenomena going, which any of you can do if you're capable of taking someone through magnetic hands or something, I know you can do that. My 10-year-old's been able to do that for a good few years. Then there's no reason you can't link that to an emotional shift about feeling good. You don't have to be specific as I was earlier on. Okay. Let's just throw one more thing out there. Let's just try this. You two guys came in late there. Gravy and Marcus, have we set anything up?
No.
Of course not. You're out to... What time did you get in last night?
What time is that?
Conference started hours ago. Let's try something. You want me in, let's try something. Okay, let's just... What I'm going to ask you to do in a moment is I'm going to ask you to visualise a playing card on here. I've got a big white card. You can go for all 52 cards. I want you to change your mind a few times, and I want you to settle on one. When you've done that, let me know.
Yep.
You done? What's the card you're thinking of?
Three of Hearts.
Is there any way I could have known that?
No.
Yeah, Marcus came and trained me about a year ago and got his suggestion. And people often ask, how long does the post-hypnotic suggestion last? And when I started reading about this 15 years ago, you'd actually get figures in books like a post-hypnotic suggestion will last for 2 weeks or 10 days or between such and such a time. And yet, in therapy work, we're always giving suggestions that you want and hope and expect will last forever. You know, someone offers you a cigarette, you'll smile and say this will be how you'll feel about such and such. The fear is gone. So my response to that and my experience these days suggests it will last as long as I tell it to last. If I want it to last for the rest of an evening, I'll put it that way. Should I come up to you and ask you a question, this will be your answer to that question. So whether that's a demonstration of a post-hypnotic suggestion lasting for months or whether it's permanosis, I don't know. What I do know is he always says Three of Hearts. There's a guy I can call in Germany right now, I know he'll say Three of Hearts, and it was a good 18 months since I saw him. So I'm going to put one more thing out there. Can you let them into the Manchu Army secret?
Ask Marcus the question.
Marcus, have you ever seen the Manchurian Candidate?
Black and white one.
Yeah. Again, it's debatable whether you should leave people with post-hypnotic suggestions, but if you rein it in, it's just fine. So a little while ago, we decided we were going to create this was sparked by an email we got from some random anonymous person called AK47. And He said that when he performs with it, as a strolling magician might, and that if he's given someone a post-hypnotic suggestion, that he'd like to be able to kind of softly test it. So he came up with the idea of giving them another suggestion that would appear to be completely innocuous. So a question. And that question, for lots of us, has now become, have you seen a Manchurian candidate? If that person says, what, the black and white version, they're part of our Manchu army. So now we've let you in on that secret, go and add as many people as you can to the Manchu army, because we might just turn up one day and ask that question when you turn up at a table. And they
need to give
them
amnesia, don't they?
And you need to give them amnesia for it as well, yes, indeed you do. Right, I'm just about done, but lunch has only just been put out there. Any question at all, not just about what I've spoken about, anything at all, anything you want me to go over, fire away.
I've noticed that nobody's mentioned anchors a lot so far.
I don't use them as much as people might imagine. I tend to use post-hypnotic suggestion, and there's quite a fine line between the two. It's just that with an anchor, you can kind of, you don't have to go through any of the formal processes of induction, that kind of thing. You can just set the person up by following the classic instructions for anchoring. Their state tends to change by giving them a unique trigger. They tend to be able to find it. The only thing I haven't spoken about is I gave Marcus our preferred way of teaching people self-hypnosis, which is to hypnotise them and give them the key and say, if you do this, this will happen. Well, that was a very quick demonstration. I'd normally bring him out completely and say, just sit there, I'm not going to say anything, repeat that word a few times, and let them go in and give them a few instructions, just literally to experience this, so they can relax about this damn floating hand, and instead start to give their mind a few more useful directions, such as when I stand up to speak tomorrow, I'll speak confidently and fluently. So to me, there's, in terms of result, there's not a great deal between hypnotising someone and giving them a suggestion. When you stand up and speak, you'll feel calm, confident, and speak fluently. And getting them to go up and fire an anchor, hear a word in their mind, and they speak calmly and confidently. I prefer to set it myself, although I guess it's more empowering to teach people the anchoring process. That's certainly how my father does it. It's kind of a gift at the end of a session. Let me show you how you can do this. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, Wayne.
Hey, Marcus was really responsive to you. What about people that are less responsive? Do you have any like techniques to build their hypnotic capacity?
I have some techniques. I mean, there are. The way I work is I aim to, if I'm kind of in entertainment mode, that doesn't mean I have to get paid for it, but I've a table of people or a party, that kind of thing. I know from experience that I can make these two little tests a party piece. I can get everyone involved, everyone whipped up into it. I can eyeball the people I think are going to be responsive to me on that night, in that mood, with me as the hypnotist. That may change. I've got to say, I just never have anyone walk out of therapy thinking or saying, you know, halfway through saying, I'm not hypnotised, that's it. It just hasn't happened. I find that I can get physical analogue type phenomena out of, pull a percentage out of the air, but the vast majority of people, I would say over 90% of people I go up to with a very simple demo are capable of this. Again, that isn't mind-blowing if you've made yourself invisible as a hypnotist and you've given people total amnesia and this kind of stuff, but if you're early into it, and certainly most lay people don't know anything about it, trust me, that will be an experience that blows their mind and they talk about. In terms of getting people more responsive, I find encouragement helps. I find rehearsal helps. I find, you know, if we reach a point of failure with amnesia, then I find that having another go, and bear in mind I've been doing this, as I say, for 13 years, I guess, when I first met James. James has been doing it for perhaps a year at that point, and he failed at amnesia very publicly. Put him straight back in, deepened it, insisted on it, failed again. Got him out. Bang, insisted, persisted, got a bit more direct, failed, bang, success. Next thing, that guy's hallucinating and the whole thing opened up. So sometimes persistence pays. There's no doubt about that. I don't think that's because they think, oh God, he's not going to go away.
I think there might have been a little bit of that going on.
But that kind of helps. But, you know, again, for us, once you get one response going, it becomes the springboard for the next set of phenomena, and I tend to link one to the other. At some point it'll collapse. If it collapses...
Can I just say on a serious point on that?
Yeah.
Although not the be-all and end-all of this reasoning, but I think one of the reasons for that can quite simply be that with the way that humans communicate, there is a disparity between what you intend to mean and what other people hear you say and how they interpret that. In my experience, although over time it's limited, essentially, but the years I've been a magician, I was a nurse prior to that, and I've done all sorts of bits and pieces in my life. I think the question is more often, did they understand what I was suggesting? And I think that sometimes the persistence isn't about repeating the same thing over and over again until they finally get it, but it's more about NLP phraseology, reframing it.
Yeah, finding a way they can get it.
So, we've learned this now. Sorry we've had to kind of cut this one a little bit short, but you don't want your sandwiches to get warm. So, it's out in the foyer where all the beautiful products are waiting to be purchased. Please be back in here 25 past, and then we'll get back on the show.